I was going to say something.
That was what you call a cold open.
I was going to say something else.
Hey, girl.
So, I'm excited to be back here, clearly. It just took all the words out of my mouth. So, I'm one of your hosts, Megan at Work, and I'm here with the fabulous...
We're about to set it up.
Goodness, is it already too much coffee?
No, it's never
too much espresso.
I'm loving this look.
Thank you.
I love it, and I love like how it changes colors. Right, let's go out.
You're gonna see a lot more of this all summer long.
I love it. You look amazing. How was California?
It was amazing.
Oh my goodness. How was New York?
Amazing.
Because she's coast to coast.
And Miami.
Oh, that too.
Yes, I got a lot of work done.
That's awesome. Really good. Well, it's great to have you back. Totally
happy
missed
to
you. So, you ready to do this thing?
I am.
All right, but first, coffee.
Well, welcome back to Mocha in the Morning. So let's get started and get to the steamer.
I know.
So much going on.
So much. And this is kind of like an elongated steamer. Mm-hmm. Usually I like to have like a few for all of you out there. But this week it's kind of like this ongoing steaming situation that we started last week with the whole, you know, families belong together, right? So truly we are going through an immigration crisis in this country. Check this out. So Senator Jeff Merkley from Oregon, he actually like went to one of these like detention centers and his access was denied. There are kids, there are children, right, that they're keeping like in cages, like all like fenced in. And we're talking about kids younger than like 5 years old being separated from their parents. And the thing is, a lot of the people that are being detained are mostly women who are fleeing from violence from these countries. I'll tell you this, not one of those people was white.
So who's detaining them? Is it?
Well, it's our government. And so this is the thing. This particular administration, the United Nations is not having it. And I think it's pretty, when the United Nations is actually standing up to the United States and calling them out on their, you know, stupidity. Let me read you exactly the quote from the United Nations. "We are deeply concerned that the zero tolerance policy recently put in place along the U.S. southern border has led to people caught entering the country irregularly, being subjected to criminal prosecution, and having their children, including extremely young children, taken away from them as a result." And that was from the human rights spokesperson. Her name is Ravina Shamdasani, I think. So it's not a good look, and we need to do something about
Something's got to change. This is just, this is terrible.
It really is terrible. It's like, it goes from trying to catfishing, you think, oh, help us find the children.
Yeah.
And it's all a setup, because that leads to trying to find undocumented, you know, people. But this is, I've never seen anything like this in my entire lifetime, not in this country. And I get the southern border, not the northern,
only the southern border.
Anyway, so it's still steaming up because there's so many other subtopics underneath that.
There's going to be a lot to come with this, so I'm sure we'll be touching on this topic.
Yes, I just know it's going to like boil over and it will be piping hot. So wake up call.
Yeah.
And speaking of which, we'll be right back after this word from the Portico. Mocha in the Morning is brought to you in part by The Portico Cafe, where conversation, connection, and community create change. Welcome back. You are watching Mocha in the Morning, and it's time for Piping Hot. This week, Piping Hot is going to get a little heavy because there are some very tender, you know, subjects and topics that we are going to address. And we think that it's super, super important. It's imperative that us as minority people and people of color address some of these issues and things that are happening within our community that sometimes might seem as taboo to talk about. And, of course, Kate Spade.
Yes.
Fashion designer, famous all over the world. I have a Jack Spade, you know, tote bag. Mm-hmm. I purchased several of her handbags for my mother. Suicide. You know, she was found, you know, hanged in her New York apartment. And from the outside, it looks like the fabulous life.
Absolutely.
And in the inside, or was it like that? Have you had any experiences with dealing with that type of issue?
Within my family, yes. Personally, no, not within myself, but just my older sister, and she had two attempts. But again, like you say, we don't really discuss that, and till this day, she hasn't gotten help. But it's something that I always worry about, because it's just, it's so apparent, it's so real, and to think that Kate Spade is someone I admired, and I recently listened to her interview on How I Built This, and she just seemed like she had everything. She had a supportive husband, she had a successful business, and then to know that throughout that whole process, she was still dealing with something internally that she couldn't just get rid of.
Celie, what did you think when you first heard of Kate Spade?
You know, I heard a lot of people that were like, well, I'm surprised. And I'm thinking to myself, having had experience with depression, knowing people that suffer with mental illness, you know, we really never know what someone's experiencing. And I think we think that because she had the perfect life, she had money, she had, you know, fame, she had all these markers that we deem as, you know, kind of the threshold for being happy. And this happened, you know, I mean, I'm certainly sad for her and for her family, specifically for her daughter. I can't imagine what she's going through. But it's something that I think, you know, it's a reminder for us to take care of ourselves, you know, from a mental health perspective. But also that, you know, that doesn't matter, right? If, you know, you could have a brand new BMW, and if something is wrong with the engine, that bad boy is not going to run. It can look real pretty on the outside, but it's not going to run. That's the same thing with mental health. Just because something looks like, you know, like it's okay, like it's great, doesn't mean that it's functioning correctly. And I think we keep forgetting that. And, you know, that's that stigma around mental health in general, especially in our community.
Now, Kia, I know that this subject matter is very personal to you. And I want to tell all of yours right now that Kia is going to share a very special story. And get very personal with us. And I want to say, first of all, thank you for doing that. And we love you for doing that.
No problem. I think, you know, it's a hard thing to talk about for a lot of people, especially in minority communities. But me personally, I tried to commit suicide at the end of 2014. I, you know, took a lot of pills and an entire bottle of NyQuil, downed it in less than 5 minutes, and then chased it with a Four Loko. I was in the hospital for a week total, and then I had to move in with my mom because she just wanted to make sure I was okay. But, you know, suicide doesn't happen like this person had one bad thing happen and all of a sudden they do this. That's not how it works. And I feel like people think that. They think that, you know, oh, they lost their job, or oh, their boyfriend broke up with them, or oh, blah, blah, blah. No, this has been a boiling point for years, maybe months, maybe doesn't matter. It just didn't happen in a vacuum. It happened over time. And what a lot of people who commit suicide think or attempt think is that the world will be better without me. My kids will be better. My husband will be better. Everybody will be better without having me as a burden on them. And, you know, that's might sound crazy, but it's what a lot of people think. You know, and it's sad and it's disappointing. And I know I had that feeling, and it took a while to get back to a normal place. But I feel like that's where Kate Spade was. And another thing I want to bring up, and why everybody was shocked when it happened to me, because I wasn't the person that was depressed and sad. You all know me. I'm Kia. I am the life of the party. I am everything. And I did that all the time in front of people. I was the life of the party, and then I was dying inside, and no one knew about it. And I feel like that's where Kate Spade was.
Well, I'm glad that you're sharing that. And of course, with your permission, I want to show everyone a little bit of your YouTube clip?
Absolutely.
What's up? I am in the car, so you're kicking the car with Kia, and this is kind of going to be a pretty serious video because I've been kind of getting frustrated hearing everybody talk about what happened to Kate Spade. She committed suicide. For those who don't know, Kate Spade committed suicide. She hung herself with a scarf, left a note behind, and, you know, said to tell her daughter that she loves her and to go ask daddy. Like, she committed suicide. So what's happening on social media and what I'm seeing on Facebook among my group of friends is people making fun of people who committed suicide. And it's not funny. And it doesn't happen in a vacuum. People don't wake up all of a sudden and say, I'm going to commit suicide. I was in this hole so deep that I just couldn't breathe. And it's not a mental illness thing. It's a depression thing. Things are so bad in your mind that you think the world would be much happier if you weren't in it, making the world bad. And I know that's in your head, and that's probably what Kate Spade was thinking. And that's what a lot of suicidal people think. It has nothing to do with all of a sudden something goes wrong, so I'm taking the easy way out. People have been going through years, months of pain.
Thank you, Kia, so much for sharing your story. It really kind of just tugs at my heart, especially since I had a sister that I'm sure that still suffers with depression. So thank you so much for that. So
you're quite welcome.
Let's move on to something that's not as depressing, but I think it's just quite hilarious.
Yes.
What a way to make a statement.
Oh my gosh. So this is hilarious. So more shade thrown at Trump for being an a-hole like he always is. Jenkins.
Yes.
Yeah.
He is flying high. Flying high with the Eagles.
So his silent press release.
Right.
That was hilarious.
Well, first of all.
Nice statement.
How you uninvite someone who wasn't going to go anywhere?
None of these things are going to the White House. They're done.
But how clever. Clever. Kia, how clever is that to hold a press conference and not say anything and just hold up a sign?
This whole situation is ridiculous. It's laughable at best because he's really like some little kid who was like, well, you don't want to come to my birthday party? Fine, I'm not having a birthday party anymore. It's like, dude, really? Yes, only two players wanted to go and a couple of the employees, but you still should have had it. It's a tradition. Just do it. It was funny to me. I was like, just have it. Now you look like a weirdo not having it. Then you're trying to sing the national anthem and you don't know the words either. So get out of here with this mess.
Seely, on that note, what are the words to the
national anthem? Oh, wait, the national anthem was the Star Spangled Banner. I meant the Star Spangled Banner. Nobody knows the word Star Spangled Banner.
No one knows.
I think what he was missing the words to was God Bless America, which was kind of interesting.
Yes.
But I could sing it, but I don't want to, you know, scare people because I can't sing, y'all. God gave me a lot of gifts. Singing was not one of them. So, but it's just been pitiful. Like Kia said, it's like a little kid uninviting people that didn't want to come to their party. And we know in the past, you know, during the Obama administration, Brady never showed up to the White House. And, you know, it still happened, right? The celebration still happened because, like you said, it was tradition. So it's just par for the course. This is what this administration does.
If you received
and that's it.
An invitation to La Casa Blanca, would you go?
That's a good question.
Yes, I would go. So here's the Republican side of me. I do agree with this. Regardless of who's sitting in the chair, it's still the White House. I mean, it's not about the chair. It's about the actual being in the White House. It's a very big deal. I honestly feel that the Eagles should have gone and maybe even been shady. Like when they take that big group picture, they all drop down to one knee. That would have been hilarious.
Yeah.
That would have been great.
Or do like a death drop, like, you know.
If we were at a drag show, then yes, that'd be very appropriate. But we're not. We're at the White House. We're just going to take a knee. Or even if they just wanted to have the conversation with him, they should have gone. And they chose not to. And it is what it is. And I know a lot of the teams are saying the same thing. They're like, well, you know, majority of the teams are black. All the black players aren't going. All the people who are scoring the points and making people in the seats. If they're not going, then the whole team ain't going. And there you go.
There you have it. Yeah. But wait. Does Seely answer the question? Your Honor, I don't think Seely answered the question.
Oh, You know, I'm conflicted because part of me wouldn't.
No, but, he meant about if you knew the words to the song. That's what he's talking about.
Yes, of course I do.
No, I want to know if she would go to the White House.
Yes. I probably would go. The pediatrician in me, I think, would like to go because I can imagine all the selfies and all of the that I would have to, you know, I can collect a whole bunch of stuff to use for later. I'm a planner, right? So it would just be something that I could use for later. But I don't know. Like he said, I think it's, you know, it's about the Republic and, you know, the office. I might go. I probably wouldn't be as happy, right, as when Obama was there. But
I know I wouldn't go.
And it depends, you know,
I'm that one.
Oh, I'm going.
No, I would have bought a ticket the last administration. I'm like, give me front row. I don't care how much they cost.
This one, I'm like, that's okay. I'm good.
Okay, well, let's move on to some amazing news.
Black girl magic.
Yes, talk about black girl magic. Black women are taking over.
But wait, can I say something? You know what keeps ringing in my head every time I think of you?
What?
It's like at our two shows ago, Megan goes, I love it when black people win. I love it when black people win anything.
I love it when black people are like, it
was so sincere and so cute the way you said it, because like you felt that that's really how you feel, and that just keeps ringing in my head. I just had to tell you that.
Yes.
I had nothing with the story. I just had to tell you that.
No, it does. Melody Hobson, she's the new vice chair at Starbucks.
Right.
So she's second in command.
Yes.
How amazing is that?
That's like a double espresso.
So, but wait, one thing. Do you think that... Seeley, do you think that they did this because everything Starbucks was going through? They had to put a black person there?
I don't know. I mean, I feel like for these jobs, it kind of happens over months. And I'm not sure if it was something that just kind of, you know, sprung up suddenly. We have all, I think, been through the, you know, the job interviewing process. I don't know if it was immediate. I would like to think that she was hired because of her qualifications, and I'm excited about that. I'm also excited that, you know, last year the COO came on board, Rosalind Brewer, and she's also a black woman. So I'm counting two now, which is you know, a good number for now.
It takes two to make a latte, right? Yes, I like that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's wonderful too. But like Seeley said, we don't know how long this has been in the works. This might have been a long process because I mean, you're finding a pretty big job. But it's not like they're looking for a barista. They're looking for like a high level executive. So it probably takes some time.
You ain't gonna get hired when you walk in, right, Kia?
Hey, I'm just saying. So, but I'm excited. I think it's great. And I've made this comment on Facebook and I've made it on Twitter. I'll make it here. We're going to get to a point where there's not going to be any white men anywhere. And it's going to be weird.
Except for like in my house.
We're okay with that.
Except for in your house.
No, the other thing, because I hear this all the time. Every time, like, the numbers come out, unemployment this, employment that, whatever, whatever. It's kind of like, I kind of feel like sometimes our government and sometimes some of the people in the government take the credit, right, for, let's say, employment numbers that have risen in the minority community. Not once have I ever heard anyone say, oh, maybe it's because more Latinos or more black Americans or more, maybe it's because we're getting like better education and actually like we're making our own numbers increase because we're out there doing the thing to get the job. Mm-hmm. Not because you made it easy for me, or not because, like, you had to meet us. They never mention, like, they take the credit for something that they didn't do. It's kind of like when people have, you know, knowledge is power. When people have access to knowledge, you could do some very powerful things.
Absolutely.
Right? I'd be a powerful boss.
Yes, I agree with that. That's very true. Well, moving on to other things.
Speaking of bosses,
Issa.
That's rough, though.
I love Issa. She's phenomenal.
I love it when clap backing, right? It's so strategically and intelligently delivered, right?
And then with the cute smile at the end.
Right.
And a possible, like, hair flip.
Right. Did you, Carol, see the dress that she wore?
I did. I saw her multiple outfits, but once she made that little joke, I didn't care what she had on. Like, straight flamed Kanye, and she did it while Kim was in the audience
with a smile on her face.
See, that's the way things should be done.
It's one step better. Kim was getting an honorary award for some fashion influencer. Who cares? You got flamed as you were getting an award. Like, that's just.
Okay, if you guys didn't hear or read the quote, this is the quote. So Issa says, "I'm about as fashionable as Kanye is black. Only when it's convenient. That joke is my choice. Just like slavery."
Flames, shots fired.
Fire, yeah. Seeley, did you write that for her?
It doesn't get old. It just doesn't get old. I mean, I melted out of my chair. Y'all seen that GIF, like, just melting. I just melted out of my chair when I heard that because it was just perfect. And, again, I loved her delivery and, you know, her poise during Shade Hey. I love me some shade, but some sophisticated shade is the best.
I mean, for some lady who writes about being so insecure, she sure is confident. You like that? You like that?
That was good.
You're so silly. A mess.
Well, I'm gonna take it on the road.
So, Issa's not the only one out here slaying, though.
No.
King James.
Yeah.
Do you like the name King James?
I don't care. I care more about the fashion tale he is setting because I've been trying to rock this look for the longest time, and thank you, King James, Queen James, whatever it wants to be,
but wait.
For validating the shorts, it's with an S, shorts, suits, and the handbag. Trust.
Wait, that's gonna be right. I have to tell you, we were in studio meeting earlier this week, and when we were showing him, and he actually, like, stopped the meeting and went looking for the short suit so he could go buy it. So this is where Jorge is right now. He is trying to find the suit. Active.
Okay, so let me just make my comment. I ain't seen a short suit since my little child wore one on Easter Sunday. Paisley or an Easter color, and you put your little cute socks on.
That's right.
The funny part. Please play the video because I need everybody to see how he sashayed out of this.
It was like, how he did it. Yeah.
What? So you gonna put? He put it. Okay. Because I just have to talk about this.
Break it down.
He's mad about a question that the sports announcers are asking, or the questionnaires are coming at him. He gets annoyed. Instead of just getting up and walking away normally, he stands up, but you can't see the shorts yet. So he stands up, grabs his headphones, puts his sunglasses on. Grabs this gigantic $25,000 alligator green Birkin bag and then sashays around the table where it slowly reveals he's wearing a short suit and high socks.
But did you also see that he pulled his shorts down too, which was the funny part. It was just, I loved it. And so part of it was that he was being kind of bullied into wanting, you know, they wanted him to say something bad about his teammate. And that's kind of what. He said what he said, and this is the new, you know, he got up and gave him a business.
Well,
I loved it.
Well, thank you, Tom Brown, who's the actual designer, who does a lot of these designer suit outfits for athletes. I'm going to have him make me one. Anyways, here's the video of LeBron seeing that walk. I mean, that's how we say it.
I don't know the question you're trying to ask.
I was just trying to see if you knew exactly what his state of mind was. Did he think that you guys had it won, or did he think he was trying to make a play? No. Not sure.
What do you mean, I'm not sure? No, I don't know his state of mind.
Did you know if he knew the score?
Thank you.
Now, see that walk. That's what I'm saying. I'm going to walk up out of the studio just
Diva.
Like that.
Yes, Diva. Yes, you better strut your stuff when you walk away to that room. That's how my mama looks when she gets mad at stuff. She grabs her bag.
Don't be talking to me.
Which means I have to go to my mom's house and grab every single handbag I have purchased for her and be like, I'm going to have to reconfiscate these because I may need them for a hot minute. And it's Florida. It's hot.
It's hot, yeah. I actually have an outfit like that. I do. I got it from Nordstrom's. It was cute.
Like, I'm tempted to cut my onesies in half so I can have like an awesome.
No. No, please stop the fashion madness.
Thank you, ladies, for joining us. Please make sure that you look out for Silericia at My Mommy Hood and Kicking It with Kia on YouTube. Always a pleasure. I totally love having all this coffee kiki with the two of you.
Have a good day, guys. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. And we'll be right back with our signature blend.
This segment is brought to you by BlackInTheBay.com, your online connection to everything that's Black in the Bay. Log on now for news, updates, and events.
Hey, this is Celie from MyMommyHood.com, and I am bringing you your signature blend. This week, we are talking about self-care. It might sound like a fad or a trend, but I think we've always needed to make sure we take care of ourselves. We just now have that word to kind of describe it. Especially, I think this week has been mental health. So we just want to go ahead and talk a little bit about it and make sure that you are open to it, that you understand that it's okay if you need a therapist, you need therapy, and speak to someone, right? There's a great website, therapyforblackgirls.com, that provides a list of therapists in your state. And I think it's something that we need to recognize that, you know, self-care doesn't look the same for everyone. And sometimes it might look like therapy, sometimes it might look like a massage, but you know, it's something that we need to recognize and understand. And we hope to be providing you some tips and tricks moving forward, leading up to Minority Mental Health Month, to make sure that we got you all together and that you are well. Stay tuned.
So we're back with the Coco clap back this week, and I cannot believe how ridiculous some of these news people are. Who are you to ever ask Serena Williams, are you intimidated? No, really? That's like impossible.
She says, his question was, have you ever been intimidated by anyone on the tennis court? And what are your thoughts about that occurrence? And of course, before that, he framed it because apparently somebody that we don't really care much about stated that Maria Sharapova, her rival, was not even really like a rivalry, but apparently that she supposedly has supermodel good looks. I don't know. So anyways, so Serena says, I honestly don't have any thoughts about that. I can't say I've been intimidated by anyone. That's all. That's it.
And on the other note, do you think that because, you know, the person that we really don't talk about, he insinuated his theory of like her alluring shoulders?
Oh, give me a break. You know what's you know what's hilarious? I want her to get that tennis racket and get that shoulder and pop him over the head with it. But anyways, then the reporter's like, you know, when he was trying to coax her into answering this question, he was like, oh, you know, we're in this together. And she said, no, we're not. You better do it.
I love how she said, you're not going home to the screaming baby.
Right.
Yeah, you're not.
Yeah, and in sort of in a way, he might be. Ooh,
oh.
We'll be right back. Thank you for watching Mocha in the Morning. If you have a Mocha moment, please share it with us. Tweet us, Instagram us, find us on Facebook at Mocha Morning Show. No G. And you know what? School's out for summer. Look at these cute little pieces of chocolate.
Thank you everyone for watching. We really enjoyed another Mocha in the Morning. We hope you all enjoyed it as well. Thank you to Celie, thank you to Kia for sharing your amazing story. You are phenomenal women. And to all the other women struggling with depression, know that we got your back. Call someone, pick up the phone, be loved on by someone. We'll see you next week.
See you next time. Can you hit my pocketbook, Sakika?